everybody, welcome to my channel. My name is Sharon, and this is a channel that is dedicated to all things related to narcissism. I've been married to a covert narcissist for almost 20 years. I'm separated from him now, and what I do with this channel is I use my real life experiences to get information out there to people about what narcissism really is, what it looks like, what it does to you, and what it does to your family. In today's video, I'm going to be talking about 5 ways that the silent treatment is damaging to you. The silent treatment, also known as stonewalling, is the purposeful and deliberate withholding of communication from an extremely disordered individual. It is meant to manipulate, punish, and control you. It's excruciatingly painful if someone's giving you the silent treatment. Humans are hardwired for communication, and what a narcissist will do is they will withhold it, and you're left stumbling around. You don't know what to do. You're in absolute anguish, but it's important, it's crucial to understand that this is deliberately done by the narcissist. They know what they're doing. Typically, what will happen is that the narcissist will do something wrong. So maybe they cheated on you. Maybe they lied to you. They did something that you found out about, and you're legitimately upset about it. Now, a narcissist is not going to deal with it. They're not going to communicate with you. They're not going to work through the relationship. They're going to shun you, ostracize you, hurt you, punish you. That's what the silent treatment is. So when they're giving you the silent treatment, they are aware 100% of what they're doing. They enjoy your pain. This really is a punishment. I've mentioned in other videos, it really would be similar to if somebody does a crime, like say my neighbor steals a car, then I go to jail for it. So I'm being punished for something I didn't do. Then at the end of the jail sentence, my neighbor comes and picks me up and acts like nothing happened. That's how they feel about me. This is how the narcissist feels about you. Somebody who can give you the silent treatment is not being silent, it's loud. They're telling you exactly how they feel about you, and it's crucial that you pay attention because it doesn't get better. Someone gives you the silent treatment one time and it works, they're going to do it again. And I get it. I understand how painful it is. That's why I'm making this video, because I want to help people who are having this done to them. Maybe this is happening to you right now and you're searching for videos to help ease the pain, to help you learn what's happening. I'm going to talk about that in today's video. So the first way that the silent treatment is damaging is because emotional pain is worse than physical pain. Memories can trigger emotional pain, but not physical pain. So if I'm telling you about the time that I broke my leg, I'm not actually feeling that pain of the broken leg. However, if I tell you something emotional that happened to me, for example, my cat died several years ago, when I'm telling you about it today, I can feel it. I can recreate that pain. It's palpable to me. Emotional pain is devastating even years later. You know, and you can see this, even people sometimes use physical pain as a way to alleviate emotional pain. You can see this in people that cut. You know, I realize that not only teen girls do this, but that's stereotypically what you think of if you think about a cutter. So I'm just going to use that as the example in the video. If you think about a teen girl who's cutting themselves, they're cutting themselves because the pain of the cutting helps relieve the emotional pain they're feeling. And I'm not a cutter, but I can understand this because towards the end of my marriage, I started getting these ear piercings because the physical pain helped alleviate the emotional pain I was feeling. You know, I started getting a cartilage piercing, then a second one, and then I started getting more painful ones. So I heard that a Daith piercing, sometimes it's called Daith, whatever it is, it's inside your ears, like right in the ear canal. And I heard that that's one of the more painful ones to get. So I wanted to get that one. So just thinking about getting it, then actually getting it, and then dealing with the recovery afterwards, it alleviated the emotional pain. I know how that sounds, but it did. So I can understand somebody who cuts. So at the end of my relationship, I got around 6 ear piercings. So I mean, if I continue on with the relationship, you know, who knows what I would look like. But this works. It helps. And the other thing, another thing that happens is that emotional pain leaves little echoes. You know, you can feel it. I had a friend of mine pass away in February. It was so painful. The day I got the phone call, I happened to just be wearing a particular shirt. I get this phone call, dealing with that day. I wasn't even thinking about the outfit I was wearing. couple days later, I went to get dressed and I decided to put that same shirt on. I couldn't do it. It brought me back to that moment when I got the phone call. The shirt was a painful trigger to something that I was devastated about. So I figured I'd eventually get over it. So I stopped wearing the shirt. A couple weeks later, I went to put that shirt on again and the same thing happened. It was fresh. It hurt so painfully. The same thing happened to the outfit I wore to the funeral. I got rid of those outfits. I couldn't wear them anymore. It was a painful trigger. So this is what happens with emotional pain. And when you're being given a silent treatment, you're feeling emotional pain. Now, another thing that can happen is that, you know, pain activates pathways in the brain. Emotional pain can activate pathways in the brain. So MRIs allow doctors to take pictures inside your body. And MRIs done on the brain show that emotions triggered by the silent treatment activates the anterior cingulate cortex. That's the exact part of the brain that detects physical pain, even if it's brief. So there's real scientific data that shows when you are feeling anguish, when you're feeling emotional pain, your brain registers it as physical pain. It's a real thing. You know, I think sometimes people think that emotions aren't as important as physical pain. Physical pain is worse. It really isn't. Physical pain is bad, but physical pain is often temporary. You know, I know sometimes people will have ongoing physical pain, but emotional pain drives people to suicide. It really hurts people. And when you're with somebody, you're with a narcissist, and they're purposely trying to trigger emotional pain, they're purposely trying to give you trauma, think about that person, what they're doing to you, what they're telling you about how they feel. Third thing that silent treatment does is it can make us angry and aggressive. It destabilizes you and it sets you on edge. When you're given a silent treatment, you are obsessed about what's going on. The longer it goes on, the more it takes up your day. You know, initially at the beginning, you might think to yourself, all right, this is going to pass. They're just upset. And the silent treatment, just so I can be clear, it isn't somebody that says to you, you know, I just need a break. I'm upset about something that happened. I'm just going to take the day. I'm going to take 2 days, whatever, to think about it. We'll talk about it later. That's not the silent treatment. Silent treatment is deliberately isolating you, deliberately hurting you. So when somebody does this, they are particularly cruel. In my situation, and I know this isn't unique, this is what happens to lots of people. This is a hallmark of narcissism and the silent treatment. So my ex would come home from work, I'd be home with the kids, and he would come in and deliberately ignore me while purposely paying extra attention to the kids. Now, everybody knew what he was doing. My kids knew what he was doing. My ex was never a particularly involved father. So he would come home and suddenly he was father of the year. And something that is particularly disturbing to me now when I think back on it, I used to really think, well, yeah, he's really hurting me and he's making me feel horrible about myself, but at least the kids are benefiting from it. At least he's being a great dad. This is right over my head that no, he was not being a great dad. The kids knew exactly what he was doing. He was never like this. They knew he was using them to get to me. This is what a narcissist does. So he would hurt me. He would ignore me. He would look right over me. It didn't matter what I said. If I cried, he would ignore me. Now, sometimes he would give me just little short one-word answers. Like if I said to him, so do you want to get pizza for dinner? He might say, yeah. But that was it. I would be in bed crying next to him and he would completely ignore me. He would roll over. He would use his phone, turn on the TV. This is abuse. When I think about it now, it's painful. It was painful then, but now I'm humiliated by it. In a million years, I wouldn't put up with it. And that's why I want you to recognize this now, at the beginning, as soon as it happens, this doesn't get better. Now, the fourth thing I'm going to talk about is that we are wired for community. Humans are wired to have other people in our life. We're not supposed to be on our own. That is why solitary confinement is a punishment. Now, I understand sometimes you might think, especially I can get this, I was a stay-at-home mom with my kids for a long time, and sometimes you get frustrated and you think to yourself, it would be heaven for me to be on this island all by myself with nobody else. That's like a little daydream, and that's fine to think about. Or even sometimes if you want an afternoon to yourself, that's normal, that's healthy. But what I'm talking about is sustained aloneness, being alone for a long period of time, completely isolated. That isn't healthy. Humans are hardwired to be connected to other people. It's part of what makes us healthy. Without it, your health starts to fade. There's a saying, and it's a trouble shared is a trouble halved. It's really true. When you talk to somebody, think about how much better you feel. Like, I have my best friend, and we talk every day, and it makes us both feel better if we're having a trouble or something's bothering us. Like, I was having some issues with my ex, and I was talking to him about it. Talking to him changed the way that I felt. Being with other people, having that connection is crucial for your mental health. And a narcissist already tries to isolate you from other people. They don't want you to have good mental health. This is classic of what a narcissist does. They isolate you from friends, they isolate you from family, so you don't have any support. So when they give you a silent treatment, you really are completely alone. You're cut off. It's the equivalent of you being all alone on a deserted island with no food, no water, no help. You're just there stranded, and eventually you're going to die. That's how it feels. It's so painful. Now, the last one I'm going to talk about is that emotional pain, silent treatment hurts even if strangers do it. It's so crucial to human happiness to be connected that even if a stranger ignores you, it hurts. Have you ever been out to eat and felt like you were being ignored by the waiter? This has happened to me before. I was out to eat with my kids a few weeks ago, and we kept trying to get like the waitress's attention because I wanted to get the check, and it seemed like she would like not pay attention to us. Now, I wasn't paranoid or anything, but it did occur to me. I felt a little bit hurt. Like, why isn't she paying attention to us? What's wrong with us? Or like if you need like a refill on your drink or something, you feel that, even though you understand logically, all right, she's busy with other people, but you feel that sting. It affects you. Or if you've ever gone out, you're driving, this has happened to me. I'll be driving down the street and I'll see one of my neighbors and I'll wave and they don't wave back. And you feel that sting of rejection. Now you recognize maybe they didn't see you, or maybe they're walking their dog and were concentrating on something else. But it's just an example of how even something small like that can sting you, even when I'm sure it wasn't deliberate. Like, I don't have any problems with my neighbors. So if somebody doesn't wave to me, I recognize realistically that they're not mad at me, they're not shunning me, but you feel it momentarily. So what I'm trying to say in today's video, and those are just some examples of some things that happen when you are shunned or you think you're shunned, it affects you. Humans need that connection. And when it is the person that you're in a relationship with, it is particularly painful. Silent treatment is abuse, pure and simple. Now, a little bit of time to be alone is okay, but what I'm talking about is a deliberate, willful, and prolonged detachment from somebody that you would expect to communicate with. It's cruel, it's immature, and it is devastating. Narcissists are all about control. They want to control every area of your life, and they enjoy hurting you. What I have learned about the silent treatment, and this is backed up by lots of evidence, lots of things I've read, people have told me the same thing that has happened to them. It doesn't get better. It gets worse. Initially, when I first started my relationship, my ex stopped talking to many of his friends. He used to be in this fraternity, and he just shut them out. It was the weirdest thing to me. I couldn't understand it. He was friends with them one day, and then he wasn't friends with them. He wouldn't talk to them. They would call, he would ignore them. It was so rude. But at the time, I was young, I was immature, I was pregnant, so I didn't really push it. And they weren't my friends, they were his friends. So I was like, all right. It was stupid of me. But that's what I did. I kind of ignored the situation. I never thought he would do that to me, just ever. I thought I was different, I was special. He would communicate with me, he would deal with anything with me. Now, it was probably a few months later, he gave me the silent treatment. And I thought at the time when he started giving me silent treatments, when he would give me a silent treatment, I thought, well, he'd never do this to the kids. No, he does it to the kids. People who give the silent treatment have something wrong with them. It's not normal. It's not healthy. It's not what somebody who loves you would do. It's fine if they want to take a little breather. You know, if you're having an issue with somebody and you say, I need a day, I need whatever. But to do this purposely, intentionally, when they know the other person is devastated, that's deliberate. It's malice. It's cruel. It's perverse. I recommend that you take immediate action. What I learned is that if somebody gives you the silent treatment, they're going to do it again. Truly, the only thing that I would suggest you do, and I know this sounds drastic, but I'm serious, end the relationship. If somebody is able to do that to you, they're able to be cruel to you. And you don't need to be in a relationship with somebody that can be deliberately cruel to you because it's only going to get worse. I'm sitting here today, 20 years later, and I don't even know how I'm going to pay my mortgage because my ex is being that cruel. He's deliberately withholding money from me, trying to harm me. This is what narcissists do. Silent treatment is only the beginning. They'll do this and then they'll do worse things. They don't care if you're involved, your kids are involved, anybody. Everything is always about the narcissist. 100% of the time, it's never ending. So if you want to have a good life, a happy life, you can't be in a relationship with a narcissist. You can't change them. They can't be fixed. There's something wrong with them emotionally. I mean, you can look at it that they have brain damage and it's not fixable. For a narcissist to change, they would have to be able to look at themselves in the mirror, understand what's wrong with them, accept the negative parts of themselves, and purposely make deliberate choices that are different than what they've made their entire life. Thank you so much for watching this video. I'm very grateful for everybody who watches my channel. I try to help people in my channel, and I hope this video has helped you. I make videos every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday on all things related to narcissism. So if you haven't already subscribed, please consider doing so. And if all goes well, I will see you in Monday's video, and I hope everybody has a wonderful weekend. God bless.